Now this is a demonstration of the subclavian vein. The subclavian vein is the continuation of the axillary vein, and we can see this axillary vein here because we have opened out the axilla to show the continuity. This is a remnant of the subclavius muscle. The other part of the subclavius muscle is visible here, so which we have pushed away. The subclavian vein, it meets with the jugular vein and it forms what is known as the brachiocephalic vein. This is the right side, so this is the right brachiocephalic vein, and this union is referred to as the venous angle. Subclavian vein has got certain differences from the subclavian artery, which I have lifted up here. The subclavian artery runs behind the scalenus anterior muscle, but the subclavian vein runs in front of the scalenus anterior muscle. So therefore, the subclavian vein is not liable to compression like the subclavian artery in the condition known as scalene syndrome. If we were to take a look at the osteology of the first rib, we will see a groove on the first rib in front of the scalenus anterior, and you'll see a groove behind the scalenus anterior on the first rib. The groove in front is caused by the subclavian vein, the groove behind is caused by the subclavian artery. Subclavian vein, when it meets with the internal jugular vein at the venous angle, this is also the site of union of the right lymphatic duct, which we cannot see because it is very small. At the termination of the subclavian vein, normally there should be a vein opening. In this case, that is not present, and that is known as the external jugular vein. The external jugular vein is formed by the union of the retromandibular vein with the posterior auricular vein. But in this cadaver, that vein is absent. And that external jugular vein is supposed to receive three tributaries. And in this case, those three tributaries, because the external jugular is absent, they are all opening directly at the right venous angle. And we can see those three tributaries here. The three tributaries are the transverse cervical vein, the suprascapular vein, and the anterior jugular vein, which is coming from the anterior cervical region, which we have removed. I would like to draw your attention to something here. In this vein which I have picked up here, this is the phrenic nerve, and we can see the phrenic nerve is coming from the cervical plexus. This is the phrenic nerve. Root value is C345, and the phrenic nerve, in the initial part of its course, it runs on the surface of the scalenus anterior muscle. Then as it comes down, it goes behind the subclavian vein, and then it enters into the thorax and it supplies the diaphragm. It also supplies the fibrous pericardium. In certain patients, the phrenic nerve has a root value of only C34 instead of the normal C345. In these cases, the fifth root comes from the nerve to the subclavius, and in which case, that is known as the accessory phrenic nerve. And the accessory phrenic nerve then runs in front of the subclavian vein, and then it meets with the phrenic nerve behind like this, where my instrument has gone in. In those cases, the accessory phrenic nerve and the main phrenic nerve, they form a loop around the subclavian vein. And that can be a potential source where the subclavian vein can be injured. Now I would draw your attention to yet another clinical aspect of the subclavian vein, which is performed in certain situations. The subclavian vein, especially on the right side, and also the internal jugular vein, by the way, is a route for central venous access. And the usual route, if I were to put back the clavicle in place, we find that the subclavian vein is running right under the clavicle. So we put in a needle flush with the skin, go under the clavicle to enter the subclavian vein, and that is known as the subclavian venous puncture. And from there we put in the cannula, which goes straight into the right brachiocephalic vein, and from there it goes into the superior vena cava and to the right atrium. So this is a very useful access point for central venous access, recording the central venous pressure, recording the right atrial pressure, and using a special instrument known as the Swan-Ganz catheter, we can let it float into the pulmonary circulation, and then it can also indirectly record the left atrial pressure, and that is referred to as the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So these are all the various maneuvers that we can do by means of a central venous access through the subclavian vein. Incidentally, the same things can also be done from the internal jugular vein. So that is another important clinical correlation pertaining to the subclavian vein. So that is all for now. Thank you very much for watching. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Have a nice day.